there's not actually going to be tea or coffee today, as we normally have. We're just going to go straight on to the congregational meeting. We just thought that would be more practical to do on this occasion. So welcome to any visitors here today, and the intimation topic later in the service. The readings today are from the lectionary, so the three-year cycle of readings, and it's just interesting how some of the readings seem to relate very much to the situation in Ukraine, and I'll refer to that later in the service. But as we come to God in worship, let us hear these words of prayer. Let us pray. God of love, God of peace, this fractured world cries out in pain, burns deep into my soul, and challenges me to make a difference. God of love, God of peace, God of this world, scarred by grief and tears, ignorance and fear, soften hearts of stone, and begin with mine. God of love, God of peace, create within me a heart for people, a desire for change, for new beginnings, to start this day. Our opening hymn is one that referred to in our gospel reading, the sense of being under the shadow of God's wings, living under the shadow of his wings. Hindu temples and Sikh gurudwaras. We grieve also for the attackers, whose faith is so distorted that they imagine you might be pleased by their actions. It's easy, God, to see where others have gone wrong, but it's not so easy to admit to our own faults and failings. We too have dishonoured you and given our churches a bad name. Whenever we have listened to gossip or helped to spread it, when we have fallen out over something that seemed important at the time, but actually matters not a jot. With anything other than worship at the forefront of our minds, when we have come in that spirit. So, Lord, we pray, forgive us and help us to undo some of the damage we have caused. Draw us into the warmth of your embrace and hold us until our anger and confusion and fear begin to dwindle, and we can go back out into the world again, ready to see other people, including those with whom we disagree, through your eyes of compassion and grace. May our journey with Jesus on the way to an end that we know so well be for us not a journey towards death, but a journey into life and hope and healing. Not for us alone, but for the world which is forever infused with your love because of him. Loving God, Heavenly Father, bless our time of worship, of gathering, of meeting together, that we may be nourished and strengthened to serve you and one another in this coming week. And now as one family, we pray together at the word Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us hear the word of God in Psalm 27. And of course, we approach God's word with our different experiences with where we are coming from in our respective lives. But I don't normally give you a prompt how to interpret it and leave that to yourselves. But as I read this psalm today, I could not help thinking of the people of Ukraine, and I think that will become clear as we hear the words. Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his tabernacle and set me high upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At his tabernacle I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hear my voice when I call, Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, God, my Saviour. Though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. Teach me your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. Do not hand me over to the desire of my foes, for false witnesses rise up against me, spouting malicious accusations. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart, and wait for the Lord. And in the New Testament, we read from Luke's Gospel, chapter 13. Luke chapter 13, from verse 31. At that time, some Pharisees came to Jesus and said to him, "Leave this place and go somewhere else. Herod wants to kill you." Jesus replied, "Go and tell that fox, I will keep on driving out demons and healing people today and tomorrow, and on the third day I will reach my goal. In any case, I must press on today and tomorrow and the next day, for surely no prophet can die outside Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together, as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" Amen, and may God bless to us the reading and hearing of his word. Now, I'm just going to say a little bit by way of introduction. Jesus says to the teachers of the law, when they come and mention Herod, "Go and tell that fox." Jesus refers to him as a fox. Now, was that a compliment? I don't think it was. And Louise, I don't know if you any know any stories with foxes in them. Do you know any stories? Yes? You think of one? Which is it? Sorry, I don't have a microphone for you. A Mr. Fox. Is it Fantastic? Mr. Fantastic Fox? Is it right? Well, that's an interesting story, because in that story you hear the fox's side of things. Because often, in a lot of stories, we hear about the bad things about foxes, but the Fantastic Mr. Fox, if it is that story by Roald Dahl, it's an interesting one, because the fox catches out some of the farmers. But in a lot of stories, certainly when I was brought up as a child, I heard about all the bad things foxes would do. Foxes would come after hens and chickens, and they still do, because we have relatives who have hens and chickens, and then sometimes a fox has got in and caused terrible harm and gobbled some of the chickens. So I think that's the kind of fox that Jesus was speaking about when he was speaking about King Herod. He was speaking about someone who would use all their skills, if you can call them that, to exploit others, to rob others, to take from others, to steal and to destroy. So, I know that we don't have foxes here to represent themselves, so it's a bit unfair. But anyway, I think that's often the line in some of the stories. So Jesus said that about the king of that area, the king of that part of Israel. So that was a very brave thing to say, a very courageous thing. But sometimes we have to be brave and courageous and say when something is just outright wrong or outright bad, and say, "Go away, fox," and maybe plan to catch the fox. So we learned something there from Jesus, that he could be very direct, he could just say things as they were, and that's what Jesus did. And he was caring and concerned for the people of Jerusalem, for the people that they might miss out on the wonderful message of God's love and God's care for them, because there were some people who were stealing and robbing them. There, that's by way of introduction. And now let's continue in our worship with our next hymn, which is a hymn of confession, a hymn of penitence. Lord, we confess, we turn away the very ones we need to be. Hediadus, I hope I've said that right. Hediadus, what is that? Hands up. No, it's a form common to poetry, where the poet has chosen two words to say the same thing from two points of view. Often in Hebrew, in lyric or poem or verse, the same thing is said twice in a slightly different way, just almost to emphasize what is being said. And so that happens in Psalm 27, it's emphasizing that strain, that theme, in the midst of everything else. The Lord is my light and my salvation. In him will I trust. God's light, God is light, God is love, God is purity, God is goodness. God's light creates my salvation. It redeems me from the pit. It takes me out of the darkness. And my salvation takes me from darkness to light. So it's almost as though one interacts with the other and enables the other to happen. God's light enables salvation, and salvation enables me to experience and be aware of God's light in the midst of darkness. I read one Bible commentary and it said that the University of Oxford took the first words of the psalm in Latin as its motto. I hope I say this right. Dominus illuminatio mea. The Lord is my light. But they didn't go on to the salvation bit. And this commentator said that was an error, that you need both. You can't have the Lord as my light without the Lord as my salvation. Both kind of are intrinsic to each other. By omitting salvation, it spoiled the depths of the psalmist's insight. And again, that's a striking thing about Psalm 27, is there is an awareness of the dark forces. There is an awareness of things that are wrong, that are human cruelty, and so on. And certainly we have been made increasingly aware of that with recent events happening in Ukraine. There's a universal theme that's expressed in Psalm 27. There is a war on. Evil assumes all kinds of manifestations: political, military, psychological, social, religious. And we kid ourselves if we think that these things are not there. There are destructive, hostile forces at work. Jesus recognized them and said, King Herod, go and tell that fox. But like the psalmist, Jesus also did the same thing. He focused on the Lord, on God, his heavenly Father, on God's will to be his light, his salvation, in the midst of hostile forces, in the midst of people persecuting him and plotting against him. Jesus did not shrug away or hide away. He continued towards Jerusalem, knowing what was going to come upon him. He uses this very evocative imagery of when he looks at Jerusalem. How I long to gather you as a mother gathers her chicks under her wings. It would have been farmyard imagery that many of the people of Jerusalem would have cottoned onto, clicked onto, this sense of this mother hen protectively gathering her chicks. There's different thoughts and stories about what that image all means. There are certainly indications that the natural maternal instinct to protect one's children would happen in the farmyard, say the incidents of a fire, and the mother hen would gather the chicks under her wings, even to the extent where it meant the destruction of her own life to preserve the life of the chicks. And of course that image or that thinking very much fits in with the theme of Jesus setting his way, progressing on that journey to the cross. Another thing in that image, the mother hen and the chicks, is Jesus is weeping as he looks at Jerusalem, because what does he see? Instead of seeing chicks coming under the wings of the Lord, he sees chicks scurrying off in the opposite direction, taking no notice of the smoke and flames indicating the approach of danger, nor of the urgent warnings of the one who alone could give them safety. They had rejected the warnings, the messages from the prophets, saying that people had to turn and change their ways, and they had carried on regardless, and now the moment of crisis, the moment of judgment was upon them. And as I say, the great danger in that imagery may have been the fire, because a fire could so destroy a farmyard, but it could also be referring to the fox. And of course Jesus refers to Herod as a fox in that same kind of context of where he longs to gather the people of Israel under his wings. And so again, as the fox, a reference to the political corruption, the machinations of the likes of Herod and some of the other ruling authorities of that time, exploiting, robbing, taking away from the people what ought to be theirs. And that's the image that Jesus uses for Herod. And it's interesting, it's a group of Pharisees who we often portray as enemies, who warn Jesus that Herod is out for him. So, what kind of Pharisees were? Were they well-intentioned? Were they caring, considerate, wanting to help Jesus, to protect him from the danger of Herod? They may have been among the many moderate Pharisees, because we only tend to hear about the ones that were kind of a bit more, let's say, bolshy and cruel in the way they treated people. But perhaps there were more moderate Pharisees like Gamaliel in Acts chapter 5, who doesn't actually put himself forward as a follower of Jesus, but does say, or were happy to watch from the sidelines and see whether or not this new movement turned out to be from God. They were kind of just, well, wait and see, wait and see. Or, another interpretation is, they may have been secretly hoping to get rid of Jesus, or telling him that Herod was after him, to get rid of him, to frighten him away. But Jesus has no intention of scurrying away like a frightened chicken. He has sent his way to Jerusalem. He has this clear sense of God's calling in his life, and he will go that painful and sacrificial journey. Jerusalem had a long history of rebelling against God, refusing the way of peace. Ezekiel chapters 10 and 11 tell you about that sense of contrariness, that awkwardness, that rebelliousness of the people of Jerusalem. And therefore they were, by that stubbornness against God's way, opening themselves to a devastating enemy attack. Jesus dismisses Herod with contempt. Go and tell thy fox. And he says, I am healing, I am doing this ministry, I'm working with people, and I'm going to do that until the third day. And there's almost a suggestion that it's a reference to the resurrection, that he has work he has to accomplish and fulfill before that time of the crucifixion and the resurrection, and he will not be diverted from it. Jesus is resolute, he's determined, he is focused on following God's way, responding to God's call. And it's interesting, you know, this is our second set of readings after last Sunday, which was the first Sunday of Lent, where we looked at Jesus tempted in the desert. And again, it was that similar thing of being tempted to follow another way, another path, a more easy path, a comfortable path, but Jesus resisted the temptations of the devil. And of course, we see it in the last week, when in Holy Week, where we remember Jesus in Gethsemane, not my will, but thy will be done. So we have a very powerful testimony in both the Psalms and the Gospel reading of this resolute focus on the will of God and the kingdom of God and not being deterred or detracted from it. May God help us to have that will inspired by the one who gave himself for us. I'd like to read this version of the Psalms. It's a wonderful book by Malcolm Wheat called David's Crown. I think Alan introduced me to it. And he kind of gives a paraphrase or a shorter version of some of the Psalms, and he does this for Psalm 27. So let me finish with this very positive exhortation on the Psalm. Oh, let me see with his eyes from now on, whose gaze on beauty makes it beautiful, who looks us into love and looks upon his whole creation with a merciful and loving eye. My heart has said of him, seek out his face. I've sensed his bountiful presence shimmering behind the dim veil of things. That presence calls to me, calls me to tremble at the brink and rim of lived experience, and then to free myself of fear, to trust him, and to dive right off that brink into his mystery, into that deep and holy sea of love, in which the living worlds all float and swim, to dare each moment's death that I might live. Amen. The choir are now going to sing the anthem for today.
Still my soul, the Lord is on your side.
Let us draw near to God and let us pray. Loving God, in praise and thanksgiving for the light and salvation that you bring to our lives, bringing hope and healing and justice. So we bring these our offerings and dedicate them in service of your kingdom. Loving, faithful God, inspired by Jesus' ability to keep focused on his goals, to hold fast to choices made years earlier, now that we could see what it was going to cost him, we give thanks for all who, like him, refuse to stop caring for others, even when they meet with nothing but cruelty and rejection. Thank you for the vulnerability that never left him and was part of his strength. Such people are few and far between, Lord, and we pray for those, ourselves included, who find it hard to stick to your way of integrity and costly, unconditional love. We pray for parents trying to give their children a firm foundation in life, especially if they have not received what they needed early on to feel safe in the world. We think of the clear vision and idealism of so many of our young people and ask that they may not become too cynical too soon. We pray for politicians and civil servants, for charity and aid workers, teachers and carers, all who choose a life of public service because they wanted to make the world a better place. Many are tired and disillusioned. Some have compromised their ideals. Some have put on a hard shell of indifference because the cost of caring and not being able to help is just too high. We pray for the people of Ukraine and the peoples of the surrounding nations. We pray that in the midst of all the cruelty and violence and turmoil, that the light and love of your salvation may draw near and be present, bringing change to those who would oppress and destroy. Pray for those besieged, that they would know the strength and presence of your love and the prayers and practical support of people across the world. For those who have had to leave their homes, we pray for safety and shelter, hospitality and care, and help us as a nation, as a people, to offer that support and care to people this time of painful distress. We pray for those who, like the people whom Jesus saw in Jerusalem, have lost their sense of purpose and direction. Those who have been let down too often to trust again. Those, again ourselves included, who cannot bear to watch or listen to the news because there is just too much suffering in the world. Too many problems that cannot be solved, too many people beyond our reach to help. Loving God, may your compassion break through all our defences. May we be willing this Lent and Easter season to take just one more risk for love's sake, and in the eternal battle between goodness and evil, love and hatred, life and death, may we discover with Christ and all his faithful servants that goodness and love and life are always stronger and will win out in the end. Let us sing our closing hymn in the service today, which is hymn 646, Fourth in the Peace of Christ We Go. Oh, sorry, before we do, I did say I was going to do, yeah, I've got to give the intimations at the beginning of the service. Just one or two intimations I want to make before we sing our closing hymn. Following the closing hymn, the benediction, we will just continue on into our congregational meeting to consider the presbytery plan proposals. And just a few dates for your diary. This Tuesday, there's a coffee club in the morning. Of course, there's Jubilee this evening, which will be here in the sanctuary on the theme of prayer. And then Tuesday evening, the Holburn Rescue session will meet, taking on board what you have shared or expressed today as we seek to formulate a response to the Presbytery Planning and Deployment Committee. And then on Wednesday, the second in a series, and if you didn't manage the first, that's okay, you can easily catch up. It's a painting each time, and it's the painting Consider the Lilies by Stanley Spencer, and that will be led by Scott Rennie, and it will be in Queen's Cross Church. I can't remember the exact name of the room, but it's the room adjacent to the cafe. The garden room. Is it just simply the garden room? It's not Rose Garden or anything, it's the garden room. Just the garden room. So that's where that Lent study will be taking place. And next Sunday, we continue to go round the different churches. So I will be at St. Mark's Church next Sunday. The Reverend Tanya Webster of Midstock Parish Church will be leading worship here in Holburn West. And then on Sunday the 27th of March, the Kirk session meets following morning worship for the approval of the annual accounts. I think these are all the intimations. You can read them in your own time. But what I would like to say, as my last response, is a big thank you to so many of the Holburn West congregation who came along to our joint service at Rubislaw. It was great to see, looking out and seeing a number of faces that I knew, and I think there was a good feeling and energy through that joint service being shared. So thank you to so many of you making that journey to Rubislaw Parish Church last Sunday. We sing now our closing hymn, 6464, From the Peace of Christ We Go.
Thank you.
God is our loving parent. We are well cared for. We follow Jesus into God's world. We go in hope. We go in love. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, descend upon you, dwell within you, this day and evermore. Saturday the 9th of April, 10 a.m. to 12 noon, it's craft, cuppy and chat in support of the Marie Curie Nursing Foundation, and there's folks in the congregation, Maggie and Anne Smith and Sheila, that I think are putting this together. So come and enjoy a cup of tea or coffee and easy Easter craft. So that's Saturday the 9th of April, 10 a.m. to 12 noon, in the Holburn West Church.